friends, Sydney siders, newspaper readers, lend me your iPads. I come to praise print, not bury it. The evil they do lives on, endlessly retweeted by university media academics. The good is often interred on page 9, just after the arts page, where everyone's debating whether Baz Luhrmann has actually read The Great Gatsby. The most noble Calvinius has told you that print is dying. If this were so, it is a grievous situation, and grievously hath newspapers answered in the hands of Calvinius and the ABC. For Calvinius is an honourable man. And while some may say, beware the Ides of March, they are only football fans miffed when News Limited put the coverage behind a paywall. But it does raise a question about the Bard and where he would be published in this era. Would he do a Dickens and serialise his plays in a newspaper? Or would he go straight to Facebook and count the likes on To Be or Not To Be? And would he remove any attribution to Christopher Marlowe before he retweeted him? As my learned friend Don Groves pointed out, Gutenberg came up with a medieval version of the internet in 1436. It led to doomsayers claiming that was the end of monks. But as anyone who's ever dropped an iPad down the loo while reading it, I believe that newspapers still have a place to play, a very important one. And there are positive signs for newspapers. Just last week, Fairfax employed 4 more journalists for its extensive and authoritative coverage of The Voice and MasterChef recaps. But to the matter at hand, is this the end of print? The question is to ask whether a newspaper is a physical form or a state of mind. After all, we download music as an MP4, but still call the work an album. And vinyl, doomed 20 years ago by CDs, which are now pondering their own mortality, is making a comeback. Granted, it's not mass market, more nostalgic cult, but it's not 12 inches of Nullius. While on the subject of seeing it all before, those marvelling at the supposedly new phenomenon of a rolling newsroom have forgotten history. As a child, I read the afternoon Sunday newspaper, Sydney newspaper, The Sun. My father was a shift worker for the Maritime Services Board, just across the road in a greasy warehouse that is now luxury apartments. The first thing I did when the paper arrived home was check the strap to see what time it had been published. The newspaper continually published several times throughout the day, just as the Herald Sun in Melbourne had morning and afternoon editions. Papers such as The Sun and The Daily Mirror kept going all day, the front page and EGN constantly updated and reprinted. So online now is back to the future. The Sun, incidentally, died in 1998, well before that interwebby thing could be blamed for its demise. Now I'd like to cast your minds back to one of my favourite predictions of the digital age, the paperless office. Paperwork is still king, but what happened was that the onus of print shifted from the originator to the recipient. I'll send you a PDF and you can print out all 70 pages of it at your expense. And hands up if you haven't sat in a meeting with a big file of printed out emails on the table. This is our future. In this era, printering producers are the love child of Caxton and the Cosa Nostra, the Sicilian mafia, extorting enormous sums of money from people who have a Tourette's-like need to keep printing in the modern paperless office. Yes, change is happening to the print media, but I'd argue that the patient's symptoms are misdiagnosed. What we're seeing now is the end of the power, the Citizen Kane-style power feared by many when in the hands of a Murdoch or a Packer or Fairfax. It's still there, but it is diminishing. And while some cheer, I do see dangers, because as a fan of Godzilla versus Mothra-style battles, you need a hero who's big and strong to fight, because there are still plenty of corporate Mothras out there who need slaying. Talking about her 15-year pursuit of Idi Obeid and her current ICAC adventures, the brilliant SMH journalist and tweeter Kate McClymont observed that she's often following the top end of town politicians or serious organised crime. What Kate failed to observe is that increasingly those all three have merged together into this one single entity.
30 seconds.
And let me give you an example of my own area of expertise, food. Many people have been rightly disgusted by the stories about animal abuse. Have seen these through the media. In America, states are currently pondered what's called an ag gag, laws that criminalise obtaining proof of this abuse and also attack media organisations who publish it. This means we're all in trouble because you need someone with deep pockets to tackle these people and such morally bankrupt laws. But back to the future of print. There's an old saying that all news is local. 20 years ago, I learnt this when I bought a newspaper in the northern New South Wales town of Lismore. I took out a personal loan and lied to the bank what it was for. We were a small free weekly. Our competitor was the century-old daily, the Northern Star, owned by APN. We succeeded because the heart of the daily tried to cover state, national and global news. We went more local, going to the kids' footy games, the Lion Club's meetings and other community gatherings. Nothing was too small. I described our paper as the conversation we used to have over the back fence. It worked spectacularly. In 2008, we sold the paper to APN for 1,500 times what I paid for it. My belief is that the future success of newspapers will be largely based on our ability to cater for smaller local groups. It is the end of mass media when it comes to print, but those backfence chats will continue in communities and these papers will be that hub. Of course, the issue is money and the debate over revenue is well known, so I won't canvass it here. But let me paint a picture for lovers of fearless investigative journalism rather than restaurant recommendations. We could see a possible paper, a crowdsource funded by small donations, in the same way that Barack Obama's re-election campaign came from $5 and $10 mum and dad donations rather than corporate largesse. And let me posit one future scenario. The paper will make a comeback, loved because it will be passed around without being tracked by Google. It will be subversive, underground and untraceable, scurrilous and highly defamatory, a little bit like an old legal pamphlet from the 1970s called Horse Talk in the time of people like Murray Farquhar and his ilk. If all this fails, I feel now is the right time to reveal the top secret project currently underway in the basement of Holt Street, where a team of Nobel Prize winning scientists are currently working on a serum that will be used to make Rupert Murdoch immortal. News Limited is hoping to make this serum available as an app to all its editors, thus ensuring that even when the readers face extinction, the newspapers will live on. And failing that, there will be large government grants available for structural adjustment for guinea pig and budgerigar owners who will no longer have proper cage linings. But let me finish with one more bastardisation. Men at some time are masters of their fates. The fault, dear reader, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are undervaluing.